Today on Ron Phillips from Abba's House.
God can take the foulest unbeliever, the drug addict, the criminal, the leader of the occult, hater of God, worst offender. And God can speak to him in the falling out and save that person and turn them into a mighty servant of God.
Wherever you've been, or what you've gone through, the Father is waiting for you.
Welcome to Ron Phillips from Abba's House. I'm Angie McGregor.
I'm Pastor Ron Phillips. Today we're going to talk about the elephant in the room.
What is the elephant in the room? Well, that elephant is falling out. This is one of those manifestations of the Holy Spirit that is very controversial and can raise a lot of eyebrows in a worship service if you've never seen anything like that
before.
That's right.
And my wife was one of the first for that happened to here at Abba's House. A classical music major, a Southern Belle, a Southern Baptist, one who really struggled when I had the baptism and when I began to have a prayer language and speak in tongues, struggled with all of it, and came to a mighty experience with God after a visit with Jack Hayford, and that resulted in the Holy Spirit just releasing her into a new and powerful teaching ministry. You're going to hear her on today's program talk about, with a lot of humor, what happened when she was slain in the Spirit, and maybe the fear of the Holy Spirit will leave you.
How well do you know the Holy Spirit? Some of us may not know Him so well. Some of us may avoid Him, as I did when I was young. I was scared to death of the Holy Spirit. Am I alone in that? I bet you were too. I didn't understand the Holy Spirit at all and didn't really want to. It was too weird for me as a 12-year-old girl and then as a 22-year-old wife when the anointing came and I ran from it. It scared me to death. But the Holy Spirit is God. Three in one, one in three, the Trinity, personhood of God the Father, personhood of Jesus Christ, personhood of the Holy Spirit, the Trinity. And since we are made in the image of God, created in the image of God, we are a Trinity too. We are body, soul, and spirit. Yes, sir. And we don't want God to ever take the Holy Spirit from us. Oh, we cannot live without the Holy Spirit. For the Word says we can't do anything in our own might, in our own power, but it has to be through the Spirit of the Lord. And once we know that, we embrace the Holy Spirit. Yes, we do. Mary found herself with child by the Holy Spirit. And then Jesus. Jesus became a man for 33 years. Lived on this earth, people, just like you and me. He got tired, he got hungry, he got thirsty. He was tempted in every way as we were. He had a time to be born. He had a time to die on the cross. He had a time for the ascension. And when he was on this earth doing all these miracles and everything, he told his disciples something that I didn't understand for a long time. He said, "Disciples, all of you are going to do greater works than I have done here." How could any person do greater works than Jesus? Well, let me tell you how. Through the Holy Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit's not like Jesus. He indwells every believer when you come to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. That's believers here. That's believers all over the world. That's believers in every generation, in every century, doing the works of Christ continuously, nonstop. Amen. That's greater works than Jesus did. And there's more of the Holy Spirit. There's the indwelling. There's the baptism. There's the ongoing. And there's the manifestations of the Spirit. If Ron and I were young again, if we were starting our ministry all over, you young people, we'd start out with an emphasis on the Holy Spirit. We would teach in our church the Holy Spirit. We were in our 40s before we were introduced to a personal relationship with the Holy Spirit. Know ye not that your temple, that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. Don't grieve the Holy Spirit. Invite the Holy Spirit. Oh my, powerful Holy Spirit. Let me just start with this. Let's go back to Pentecost. That's where it all started. Now, Pastor talked last week about the dove, so we're not going there. It was mighty about the dove. But there are other symbols of the Holy Spirit, too. You got the fire. You got the wind of the Holy Spirit. Now, before Jesus ascended into heaven, he told his disciples that they would receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost would come upon them and they would be witnesses in their hometown, in their county, in their city, in their state, in the world. Now, this is Paulette, this is not in the Word, but I don't believe they had a clue what Jesus was saying. Because I didn't have a clue about what Jesus was saying about the Holy Spirit. I don't know that they understood what they were waiting for in Jerusalem. Jesus said, tarry in Jerusalem till I come and I'm going to bring you the Holy Spirit. And he said he'll be a helper, he'll be a counselor, he'll be this. But I don't think they had a clue what was coming. But they were afraid because the authorities were trying to stamp out this new religion. The authorities were trying to nullify the fact that Jesus had raised from the dead. And the authorities were looking for everybody that believed in him. So when they were in that upper room in Jerusalem, don't you know the doors were locked? Don't you know the shutters were barred on the windows? They were afraid. 120 afraid, intimidated, fearful, shy believers waiting for something they didn't know what they were waiting for. I don't know what they were doing in that room, but I figured it was all night long because the Holy Spirit came real early in the morning. Maybe they were fasting, maybe they were praying, maybe they were testifying, maybe they were singing, maybe, I don't know what they were doing. But they were in one accord, and they were waiting for something from God. Are you waiting for something from God? Always. Always. And when the Holy Spirit came, he came in wind. Hurricane, force, wind. Tornado, force, wind. Winds in that upper room, blowing open the doors, unbarring all the windows, tongues of fire on everybody's head. Now, I can't even imagine what that looks like. I see pictures, but I don't think we know. Fire. Fire means passion. Fire means burning for God. I bet they ran out that door and ran in the streets of Jerusalem completely. Controlled by the Holy Spirit. And if you're filled with the Holy Spirit, that means you are consumed. You are controlled. It is God in you and not you anymore. It is. Now, when they left that room, God turned 120 timid, shy believers into flaming evangelists that would eventually change the world and go out of Jerusalem. Now, what did they do? I imagine a lot of them were trembling. I imagine they were shaking. And if you've trembled under the Holy Ghost, you know you can't stop it. I imagine some of them were weeping for joy. I imagine some of them were dancing in the streets. That's the one I'd want to do. Dancing in the streets, laughing like Rodney Howard Brown. Hands held high in worship. Totally in the third heaven of joy. Moaning, groaning in prayer. And all of us have had that kind of prayer, haven't we? But let me tell you something. God understands moan. That's his language. God understands groan. And the Holy Spirit will make groanings unutterable for you. These people were doing all sorts of things early in the morning in the streets of Jerusalem. Running around, shouting, kneeling, praying, falling out. God help them. Laying hands on people and speaking in tongues. Speaking in languages that they did not know. And people all through the city understood their own language. Speaking in tongues probably that some didn't understand. But it was evident. People could see it. People say, these people are weird. These people have lost it. They're off their rocker. They're drunk as Cooter Brown. And Peter said, oh no, nobody here is drunk. It's 9 o'clock in the morning. They are full of the Holy Ghost. Now, why do I tell you that? Because when they were in that upper room, they were not full of the Holy Ghost, and nobody knew they were believers. It was on the inside. But when the Holy Ghost gets on you, it becomes observable. You can see it. It is visible. You can hear, see, smell, taste, or touch it. Because what? It's on the outside. That's called a manifestation. When things get on the outside. Mamas, if you have a sick baby, you don't know it's chicken pox till you see the bumps come outside. That's a manifestation. And that's what God did at Pentecost. And that's what he does for you when he fills you, when you have a touch of the Holy Ghost. He takes that love for him that's on the inside and he spreads it out so everybody can see it. Yes, he will. That's called a manifestation. So firstly, I just want to tell you, don't be afraid of the Holy Ghost. Don't do like I was. Don't be afraid of it. God does all things well. His ways are not our ways. They're mysterious. But you know what? We are natural. We are limited. But our God is not. He does everything the heavenly way. He is supernatural. Above and beyond all. Don't be afraid. And I imagine all of us, when we first became believers, we thought, oh, all those songs we sang, we said, Lord, take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to you. Lord, let me live for Jesus. Whatever it takes, I want to serve you. I want to be a believer, a disciple. But I don't think we really totally meant that. I think I kind of meant, Lord, I want you to lead me where I want to go, where I'm comfortable going, where I know where I'm going, where I can do, I know I can do what I can do if we go where I want to go, but I'm afraid of you. And I was afraid he'd call me to be a missionary in Africa, because that didn't appeal to me at all. You're afraid of the things of God because they're so much bigger, magnificent than anything that we can encounter. Don't be afraid. Say, Lord, I will go. I'll encounter anything you have for me. No restrictions, no holds barred here. None. Holy Spirit. And in the end times, people, which we are living in, we're going to need more of God. We're going to need him in a tangible, practical, everyday manifestation to get through. So we need him.
What if you could have an inner power that gave you strength, helped you know what to do, and could release miracles in others' lives? Dr. Ron Phillips had a powerful encounter with the Holy Spirit and has spent almost 30 years learning, teaching, and operating in the power and anointing of the Holy Spirit. Now, he shares his extensive knowledge and experience with you. Call now and receive the four books that together make up the definitive guide to the Holy Spirit. The Foundations on the Holy Spirit set includes essential guides to the baptism in the Holy Spirit, speaking in tongues, the gift of healing, and spiritual gifts. Yours for a donation of $50 or more. Shipping and handling is included. Plus, call now and we'll include an exclusive teaching with Ron Phillips and Perry Stone, answering some of the tough questions about the Holy Spirit. Call now with your gift of $50 or more, 1-800-877-6493, or log on to ronphillips.org.
Elephant in the room happens every Sunday in this church. Sometimes just a few, one or two, sometimes everybody in the whole church. And it's called falling out, being slain in the Spirit, resting in the Lord, trance-like state. And we see it almost every Sunday. But I dare say nobody discusses this at the dinner table on Sunday. Nobody brings it up with their children. Nobody asks God, what's going on? What are you doing by this? And God does not waste anything. There's always a purpose. There's a reason behind it. And he'll let you know what it is. It's the elephant in the room. Well, we're going to deal with the elephant in the room today. This falling out in the Lord. And I am not questioning what God can do. because there's probably so much more that we haven't even experienced yet. But don't make the mistake that I made by prematurely condemning or running from that. You're going to miss out. You're going to miss out if you do. Don't be afraid. Number two, do not resist God. Oh, believer, do not resist God. I think about 1997, one of the three largest ladies' night out we ever had, and we had Judy Jacobs preaching. I had never heard her preach, I'd just heard her sing. Great anointing. God said, invite her. And I said, oh, I don't know, Lord. He said, invite her. I did, not knowing. Pastor came in and laid hands on all the leadership for the women in the women's ministry. I thought, this is strange. He's never done this before. He said, you have the anointing now to pray for people. That night when Judy Jacobs preached, and I mean that woman can preach, three-fourths or more of the women in that auditorium were prayed for that night. God was moving. It was powerful. And probably 100 of them were on stage that had been prayed for that night. Well, I was standing beside her on stage, and she had the mic, and she was still going pretty strong, and it was over, I thought. And she turned to me with that mic. I thought she was going to hand it to me to end the meeting and close it out. And she started prophesying on me, and guess what? I fell out on stage in front of all those women. I mean, a lot of women, and I knew some of those women, a lot of those women. We didn't have catchers. We didn't have cloths to put on over your knees or anything. I don't know how long I was out. I knew I didn't do it. I would never fake anything. I didn't even want it. I was the last one in the church that even wanted it. Pastor, can you say amen? You know I didn't. And to be perfectly honest, I was embarrassed. I was so embarrassed. I guess I have pride. I was a high school English teacher, and I love what I did. I was a classical musician back when I could practice. And I'm a Southern lady. And if you're from the South, you know exactly what I mean. If you're not, that's a story for another day. But a Southern lady will never embarrass herself or her family. Not intentionally, anyway. I was embarrassed. God had laid me out and put me on display, humiliated me in front of the people I worked with. I was their ministry director for, I don't know, 15, 17 years at the time. I didn't like it. I digress. About a year later, maybe not even a year, Pastor and I went to a Rod Parsley meeting. I couldn't even define the word Pentecostal, much less know what's going on in a Pentecostal venue back then. We wanted to hear Benny Hinn, and Benny Hinn was preaching there. We'd never seen Benny Hinn. So we go to this camp meeting. They seat us on the third row, right back there, Teresa, about where you are. We were the last two on the end of the pew. Well, Pastor Benny's walking around just preaching a good sermon, and all of a sudden, I mean, we're minding our own business in about 3,000 people. He walks over to the third row to us, lays his hands on us, and says something. We were out. We don't know what he said. Out in the spirit. Am I telling the truth? Thank goodness most people couldn't see it because we were sitting down. Here again, I'm embarrassed. Lord, what is this about? I don't like this. And that night, they invited us to go back in the back with all the program personalities and eat dinner. I didn't know a single person in that room, and there's probably 40 or more, but we were the token novelty of the day. We were the Baptist moving in the Holy Spirit, and everybody wanted to see us. We were weird. Not many Baptists go there back then. So this older gentleman comes up to, well, Ron's down the buffet line. You know, he's first. He's passed me on by, and I'm way behind him. I'm getting started at the buffet line, and this older gentleman, I don't know if he spoke to me, shook my hand, introduced, I don't know what he did, laid his hands on me or anything, but his last name I learned was Shambach. And this is true. I was laid out in front of the buffet line. People had to step over me if they wanted food. And I don't know how long. I'm humiliated. And then the same guy, Shambach, I don't know his first name, but he was a preacher. He went to the end of the buffet line, I learned later, and did something to Ron. And Ron was laid out at the end of the buffet line. So nobody could eat till the Spirit got through with us. Am I telling the truth? Embarrassed by the Holy Spirit. But I knew that night I had nothing to do with it. I knew I didn't. And Judy, when I finally got up, Judy handed me the mic. I stumbled through a prayer, and I went home as fast as I could. Now, you know, my daughters were there, and they were in college at the time. And this is true. They went and called their dad. Do we need to get an ambulance? Something's happened to Mom. She's unconscious on the floor of the stage. I didn't do that. I had nothing to do with it. And I was confused. The one thing the Lord told me after that was, these women have known you a long time. They know the good and the bad about you. They know that you're sincere. They know you would never do this on your own. And I want them to know that what I'm doing through you, I can do through them. So he used me as an example. I could be trusted, and the people would believe him through me. Well, it happened. Finally, God said, embarrassed? You can choose to be embarrassed every time I move in your life, or Paulette, you can just get over it. I'm telling you, that's the way God speaks to me. He's direct. I decided to get over it and embrace it. And I began to ask God. I began to believe because it was God. And something rose up in me and I started to say, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God. It's the power of God in me, and there's a purpose in this. And God did this intentionally, and I want to know why. And being the good Baptist girl that I am, I said, God, I cannot embrace this until I find it in your holy word. So God, if he chooses to make you fall out, maybe he has a healing in store for you. Healing your wounds, whether they're physical or emotional or diseases or memories or unforgiveness. God may have a healing in store for you. That's biblical. Do you need some promises from God? It can happen in the falling out experience. Do not waste it. God does not waste a falling out experience. If it happens to you, you need to find out why and what God wants to do with it. God can take the foulest unbeliever, the drug addict, the criminal, the leader of the occult, hater of God, worst offender. And God can speak to him in the falling out and save that person and turn them into a mighty servant of God, a leader and a warrior for the things of God. You believe that? Thou need an amen. I know people that he's done that to. Jerked them up and turned their lives around. And I'm here to tell you, people, that's what God did for me in that first falling out experience in front of Judy Jacobs and about 500 of our women. Took a while to figure it out and pray it through and search the scripture. But as a result of that, God said, Paulette, I want you to leave school teaching. And I said, oh, Lord, I don't know about that. I can retire in 5 years. I know how to do this. I do it pretty well. I can do this every day of my life and be completely happy. My life is in order. God said, I want you to teach for me. And he changed my life. He doesn't have to do that for you, but that's what he did for me. He changed my life totally in a different direction. And it's all good. And I praise his name for it.
Well, I know you have learned a whole lot from Pastor Paulette about this specific gift. But, you know, there are a lot of gifts. And Pastor Ron, I'm wondering, why do we need the spiritual gifts, these tangible things, when we have Jesus in our heart?
Well, we need them so that God can act in our life in ways that we can't explain. Mm. And the spiritual gifts are one of those ways, and manifestations. It's not only falling out, it's trembling, it's crying, There's been a manifestation of joy. There's a lot of them out there, and we're so afraid of embarrassing ourselves that often we miss what the Holy Spirit wants us to have. We don't want you to miss any of it. That's why this four-part series on the baptism of the Holy Spirit, speaking in tongues, the gift of healing, and all of the 19 spiritual gifts, these studies are available to you for your gift to the ministry. And for an added gift, we'd love for you to have all of this humorous, powerful, gracious teaching my wife has just given you. I don't believe it gets any better. I've never heard a teaching on being slain in the Spirit at all. And especially one this clear, this real, and this powerful. We want to help you be all God wants you to be and take the fear away from allowing the Holy Spirit to do what He wants to do in your life. Call us now.
The Holy Spirit is a mystery to many people, but Ron Phillips helps you understand the basic foundational truths of the Holy Spirit. Call now to receive the four-book set on the foundations of the Holy Spirit, plus a bonus teaching by Pastor Ron and Perry Stone. Yours for a gift of $50 or more. Shipping and handling is included. In the set of four books, you'll learn what the Bible has to say about some of our religious prejudices against the Holy Spirit. Discover how to discern a true word of knowledge. Find out the benefits of speaking in tongues. And learn what the Bible has to say about doctors and healing. What if you could have an inner power that gave you strength, helped you know what to do, and could release miracles in others' lives? Dr. Ron Phillips had a powerful encounter with the Holy Spirit and has spent almost 30 years learning, teaching, and operating in the power and anointing of the Holy Spirit. Now, he shares his extensive knowledge and experience with you. Call now and receive the four books that together make up the definitive guide to the Holy Spirit. The Foundations on the Holy Spirit set includes essential guides to the baptism in the Holy Spirit, speaking in tongues, the gift of healing, and spiritual gifts. Yours for a donation of $50 or more. Shipping and handling is included. Plus, call now and we'll include an exclusive teaching with Ron Phillips and Perry Stone, answering some of the tough questions about the Holy Spirit. Call now with your gift of $50 or more, 1-800-877-6493, or log on to ronphillips.org. Are you ready to walk in God's power like never before? Now more than ever, it's time for the church to rise up and operate in the power of the Holy Spirit. Hear from Ron Phillips, Ronnie Phillips Jr., Perry Stone, Damon Thompson, Randy Caldwell, Rabbi Kurt Landry, Dwayne Miller, Tony Valdez, and Matt Smith for Fresh Oil New Wine, Rise Up, March 5th through 9th at Abba's House in Chattanooga. Plus, a women's luncheon with Sandra K. Williams and kids' services with Jeff McCullough. Go online for a complete schedule and to register at fonw.com. It's time to rise up.